I have these weird fantasies about China. Like, I am fourth Vice Premier Ka Sindo, presiding with President Xi Jinping at a military parade in Beijing.
Kai Sera!
Let's begin.
Oh, and this Russian VIP is my guest. And you remember Tank Man, that incredibly brave guy with the shopping bags in Tiananmen Square in June 1989. No one ever identified him. But in my second fantasy, Tank Man's secret is revealed. Viewing a tour company's online video, I realized that I could actually visit the scenes of my China reveries.
The mysterious East. What's beyond the Great Wall? Imperial China. Tibet. The Yangtze River. Ancient. Complex. Intriguing. There's no limit for discovery.
The Year of the Monkey was an auspicious time for the escorted tour. As a casual student of Buddhism, I believe I may be a reincarnated cat, so I did special research on an ethnic minority called the Miao people. I boned up on history, too. Through 19 imperial dynasties over 2,000 years, the Middle Kingdom invented gunpowder, fireworks, silk making, the compass, printing, paper money, even toilet paper. In Tiananmen Square on October 1, 1949, Communist leader Mao Zedong proclaimed the People's Republic of China. On the new flag, a big star for the Communist Party, satellite stars for the four social classes: workers, farmers, soldiers, intellectuals. Mao's misguided 1958 Great Leap Forward commanded peasants to make steel. The backyard steel was useless, and lost food production caused famine, killing millions. In 1966, Mao started the 10-year Cultural Revolution. Young Red Guards beating teachers, high officials exiled to field labor, universities closed. Yet in 1972, Mao and President Richard Nixon reopened U.S.-Chinese relations. The world changed overnight as Nixon climbed the Great Wall.
I think that you would have to conclude that this is a great wall.
Chinese leaders later regretted choosing the Shui Guan area for Nixon's visit. Shui Guan translates as Watergate. Mao died in 1976. Reformer Deng Xiaoping, recalled from exile, swiftly imprisoned Mao's fourth wife, the actress Zhang Qing, and her radical Gang of Four. Under Deng's socialism with Chinese characteristics, China became assembly line to the world. But all that capitalism, powered by coal, has produced killer air pollution. Economic prosperity led to Tiananmen Square, student demands for democracy. Deng unleashed the People's Liberation Army. Protesters were massacred. Washington-Beijing relations have had their ups and downs since then, but they've come a long way from the Korean War. Yao Ming starred in the NBA, for example, and Chinese food is a beloved staple of American life. Back home, the Chai Coms cling to power by stifling dissent, imprisoning artist Ai Weiwei and other nonconformists. The remote Xinjiang Uyghur Autonomous Region is a hotbed of Muslim protest against religious restrictions. China has suffered some terrorist attacks in consequence. Against that background, my wife Irma and I flew to Shanghai, met by OAT tour director Susan Li, Chinese name Li Ji. Bill Merkelson of Los Angeles was one of Susan's five Shanghai tourists, along with Marty and Diana Finkelstein of Larchmont, New York, Irma, and myself. First impressions, the crowded nation of 1.3 billion people is clearly a one-party communist country. Heroic socialist soldiers dance on TV. The banks and many other companies are owned by the government. News and information are heavily censored. Under more enlightened red policies, though, China is one never-ending construction project. There's a joke that the national bird is the crane. Impressive investments in infrastructure fund new bridges, airports, a vast network of bullet trains. In 1980, Chinese traffic meant bicycles. Now, millions of cars, insane traffic jams, and even more air pollution. To the government's environmental credit, scooters and motorbikes must be electric. The party makes a tough bargain with the people. We'll let you get rich through private enterprise, but leave politics to us. Despite China's breathtaking rise to world power status, the tap water remains third world in bacterial effulgence. You're advised to use bottled water or to boil water. Well, the leadership shrugs, we are still a developing country. Not all the bathrooms, which Susan called happy rooms, make Westerners happy. American tourists, 2 million of them last year, can feel almost at home, though, finding familiar stores and name-brand products. More baffling is all the Chinglish, hilariously off-target English. My favorite, this No Luahua Chaos command on the Great Wall. It meant, hey, big-nosed foreigner, don't cut your sweetheart's name into the ancient stones. Almost every t-shirt you see in China is in English, but some of their messages make no sense either. Dining, you are apt to find strange foods. Dragon fruit, lotus root, die-hard yam for breakfast, and pancakes called pan-fry waffles. What you won't find are fortune cookies. First sightseeing stop, Shanghai's European-style Bund, the classic riverfront art deco of 100 years ago. The Bund recalls a century of Western domination of coastal China, hand-pulled rickshaws and all. The new China towers across the river in the ultra-modern Pudong New area, barely visible through the lung-irritating smog. For me, it was a sentimental visit to my shirts, most of which come from China. At the Shanghai Museum, a stirring introduction to centuries of Chinese bronzes and porcelain, not to mention the meow. Next day, a bus ride to Zhujiajiao, a touristy old fishing village with scenic bridges and the first of a lot of boat rides.
Ning hao, ning hao.
Allergic to rabbits?
Yep.
How do you know?
Because I had them.
Ah. Another day trip introduced us to China's high-speed Shinkansen train. Sounds an awful lot like Japan's Shinkansen. Racing 60 miles west to Suzhou.
Hello.
Formerly known as Suzhou, the elegant canal city of 10 million was called by Marco Polo the Venice of the Orient. So naturally, we got another boat ride. Back in Shanghai, Cao Yang Xin Tsun, a model village built in 1951 for textile workers who met their quotas. Presidents Jiang Zemin and Hu Jintao have signed the visitor's book, with local guide Joyce Ju translating. Retired teacher Ding Xu Yuan filled us in over green tea.
What did he say?
Mrs. Yi served us a home-cooked lunch in her 750-square-foot, $900-a-month apartment, a welcome glimpse of how working-class Chinese live. We were to fly to Beijing, but deadly tornadoes canceled flights. We made the 600-mile trip via another high-speed train, reaching 192 miles an hour. There was a long weather delay at Chufu, hometown of Confucius, 6th century BC sage of familial piety and social stability. At the Hejing Fu Hotel, we met new group members, Darla Elliott of Ohio, Bill Fizdak of Florida, Kimberly, Barbara, and Ken Hand of Tempe, Arizona, and Nasi Ranama of La Jolla, California. We set off through the capital city of 22 million, surprisingly appealing despite the face masks and the soldiers patrolling foreign embassies. In smoggy humidity, Tiananmen Square, Mao's mausoleum, closed for repairs. The Great Hall of the People, where the rubber stamp Congress meets. The Monument to the People's Heroes, center of the 1989 democracy rallies, guarded so they don't happen again. The old imperial gate of heavenly peace, historically so important to China.
I expected it to be busier, with troops marching, but I miss that.
The iconic setting did inspire Irma to break into a dance of solidarity with the class strugglers of the world. Some 55 miles northeast, overseas adventure travel had a so-called wild section of the 1,400-mile Great Wall of China to itself, free of tourist mobs. China is named for Emperor Qin Shi Huang, the Caesar who first unified China and built the wall around 221 BC. Qin did not ask those pesky Mongolians and Manchurians to pay for it. High above that Qinglish warning about rock carving, the government, so efficient at censorship, had mounted a sign backward with the blank side facing the wall climbers. Now that's what I call Luahua chaos. Correct pronunciation, Luahua chaos. Chairman Mao said, "He who has not climbed the Great Wall is not a true man." So we climbed the steep, uneven steps, triumphing alongside a local guide called Mountain Goat.
The casual walk on the Great Wall was amazing because there was no one else there on the side that we were at, and it's one of those top bucket list adventures to do.
Back in Beijing, a distant glance at the 2008 Bird's Nest Olympic Stadium and the 7-star luxury hotel in dragon shape built for those games. The hotel's awkward name, the Fanggu. Through the Gate of Heavenly Peace into the Forbidden City, sprawling palace of 24 Ming and Qing emperors for nearly 500 years, until the boy emperor Pu Yi was kicked out in Sun Yat-sen's 1911 Republican Revolution. The Forbidden City is no longer forbidden to the people, but right next door is Zhongnanhai, tightly secured working offices of China's top communist leaders, ordinary folks called those officials the Big Potatoes. The beautiful Temple of Heaven was the place of worship for Ming and Qing rulers, especially its harmoniously proportioned Hall of Good Harvests, one of China's most famous structures. In the temple park, the people in their morning recreation. Well fed, we learn that China also invented the Lazy Susan, that rice is served last and that plates are often tiny. We got a lesson in how to eat Peking duck. And when eating noodles, just slurp them up without formalities.
The food is very much like Chinese food at home. The only problem is I don't eat Chinese food every day at home. And so I'm beginning to miss Western food.
The favorite retreat of the powerful last Dowager Empress Cixi Shi and her favorite eunuchs was the breezy Summer Palace. Its artificial Kunmin Lake is a mandatory stop for tourists as well. A night market, soon to close, where offbeat foods are sold. No dogs or cats, thank God, but what appear to be cockroaches and scorpions. The 23-day tour was not all chopsticks and temples. It was culture, too, like this evening of classic Peking opera. If the sopranos sound like cats meowing, that's the tradition. At a drama and dance school where half the students want to star in Peking opera, the teachers were hard at work. In the shadow of the ancient drum tower, one of Beijing's last few hutongs, narrow alley neighborhoods where dogs are blocked from peeing on tires. Don't let the apparent poverty fool you. Xi Jinping himself owns one of these coveted houses, some with solar power. In a second home visit, Li Xiaojing described her family's hutong home, 600 square feet, toilet and shower in the public bathroom across the alley. Value of the house, $2 million. The government owns all of China's land, and if you buy a house, you supposedly keep it for only 70 years. Before Mao took power, the Li family owned a big hutong compound, but now granddaughter Xiaoqing is reduced to painting snuff bottles for a living, from the inside. Nassi, an art teacher, tried her hand at it. Bill Merkelson looked on as his gift to the hostess, a $2 bill, found its place on a wall of foreign money. Bill had more such gifts on tap in his wallet, prompting his inevitable nickname, $2 Bill. Fast train 733 miles down to Xi'an, proud and very old capital of Shanxi province. Along the railway, forests of new high-rise apartments and the factories and coal-fired power plants that haze the skies over Xi'an. Xi'an, considered mid-sized at 8.4 million people, brags about medieval city walls and a bell tower that used to ring the time of day. Did we stay at the deluxe Bell Tower Hotel? No, we stayed at the Ramada Bell Tower Hotel, where the hairdryer was not complimentary, it was uncomplimentary. Chinglish! Another American brand nearby, Pizza Hut, where we downed a Corona. Why do millions of people visit formerly off the list Xi'an these days? Well, near the foot of Black Heart Mountain, 20 miles east, is the hilly tomb of Qin Shi Huang, vainglorious first emperor of all China. Nobody knows exactly where this military conqueror is underground. The mysterious tomb is booby-trapped, but a mile away in 1974, farmers digging a well broke through to Qin's previously unknown terra cotta army. Qin prepared for an afterlife where he would rule an underground world. For 37 years, he put 700,000 coolie, heavy laborers where the word coolie comes from, to work making 8,000 life-sized clay soldiers.
Our warriors and steady rank assemble. Never quail or they conceal it if they do. And they shouldn't be surprised if nations tremble before the mighty troops, the troops of Titipu.
Xi'an, formerly called Chang'an, was where Silk Road camel caravans started on their age-old trade path to the Mediterranean. The city walls are 11 miles around, and you can ride bikes on top. At the 6th century small wild goose pagoda, where Buddhism was introduced to China from India, Nasi banged the gong. Xi'an is where Susan, a Westerner from Xinjiang, now lives, and she hired Tai Chi Master Niu to teach us his art. 18 miles west of Xi'an is Dongguan, a wheat and corn farming suburb with close ties to our tour company. We took electric tuk-tuks to an old mud-walled village the government is tearing down. Overseas Adventure Travel calls this mingling with Dongguan's locals a day in the life. Okay. Susan showed us around the place, pointing out the blackboard where Red Guards gave the villagers work assignments during the Cultural Revolution. By prearrangement, an elderly woman, a last holdout from the bulldozers, invited us in to observe her fading way of life. We were about to get a grander welcome in the new village where farmers were relocated. You would hardly call the place a village, really, not with expensive high-rise condos blocking the sun from the spacious worker houses. Wang Yafun, a truck driver's wife who runs a small village grocery, made us lunch. She told us that in 2006, villagers in China became the only citizens lucky enough to get to vote for their officials. Number two daughter Wang Yueru, a smart fifth grader, chimed in. $2 bill struck again. At the Guangming Primary School, where OAT's Allied Grand Circle Foundation has donated a computer room, a fifth grade class of 38 kids swarmed the big noses and walked us into the sweltering classroom.
Yeah.
After the youngsters had rendered China's national anthem, we observed an English lesson, left our own gifts, and drove back to the city. Xi'an by night, with a walk through the popular Muslim quarter. The Hui people are regular majority Han Chinese, except for their religion. Xi'an never forgets that it was China's capital during the Tang Dynasty from 581 to 907 AD, golden age of art, music, and poetry. Chengdu is a high-tech metropolis of 9 million, capital of Sichuan province, famous for its spicy dishes. Yet Americans would never hear of Chengdu if it were not for those adorable symbols of China, the endangered giant pandas. At the breeding center, a rainy morning roused the sleepy, bamboo-addicted pandas to horseplay, or rather, bear play. In Chinese, pandas are sung mao, bear cats.
Oh, they're biting each other. Oh,
look at them. They're climbing on the top.
Also in danger, the red panda, not a bear, but a cousin of the raccoon. People's Park, where Chengdu goes to relax. Matchmaking parents, despairing that their busy offspring will ever get married, tout their children's virtues to other parents in the park. Think of it as a low-tech version of Match.com or JDate.
I really enjoy just mingling with the locals. That's how I get to know a place. Not visiting their famous sites, but looking at the people on the streets and their daily lives.
At Chengdu's airport, Irma struck up a people-to-people friendship with a Tibetan Buddhist monk returning from lecturing in the United States. And with Chengdu, the gateway to Tibet, we took off for the high-altitude roof of the world. In 1950, Mao Zedong invaded independent Tibet, peaceful land of the Yak, reducing the young ruling Dalai Lama to a figurehead. He fled to India after a failed 1959 rebellion. Descending over the Himalayas and the Brahmaputra River, we witnessed China's heavy-handed military presence in restive Tibet. In 2008, some felonious monks rose up, killing a few Han Chinese. Beijing came down hard, at times closing Tibet to tourists. Few Tibetans are allowed to go anywhere else in a wary China. On the bus into town, we were awarded scarves of welcome and tribute, devoutly Buddhist Tibet's version of the Hawaiian lei. Local guide Nima Wangdu outlined his life story and the slow disappearance of the Tibetan language and culture, touching discreetly on his 3 years in prison for expressing pro-independence views. Maybe that funny t-shirt had a political message after all. Bustling Lhasa, now mostly Han Chinese, in its newer districts looks much like other China cities, except for a golden yak and a monument to the falsely claimed peaceful liberation of Tibet. at our Minshan Hotel, its five floors bizarrely numbered because of the owner's superstitions, a government employee propagandized us about the so-called peaceful liberation. I wanted to slug her. In room 1010, Irma inhaled oxygen to survive at 12,000 feet. We felt as if we were on Mount Everest, 370 miles southwest. Lhasa hosts plenty of foreigners, but our first lunch apparently was considered such a local novelty that it was taped for cable TV. Tibetans, historically influenced by India, don't use chopsticks, and they know what foods Americans crave. The imposing Potala Palace, since the 7th century, the hilltop seat of Tibet's kings and ruling lamas, the Dalai Lama's flag supplanted by that of Beijing. To view the 27 gloomy rooms open to the public out of the Potala's 2,000 rooms, you have to climb 13 stories in the thin air. Unacclimated, somehow we all made it up to the highest courtyard. On a rainy morning, the Jokhang Temple, oldest Buddhist shrine in Tibet, and a destination for pilgrims from all over the Alaska-sized region. China is officially atheist, but at 18% of the population, Buddhism is the country's largest religion. The Barkhor Bazaar, typically Tibetan in architecture, and in pilgrims twirling prayer wheels. The aprons, called ban din, are the mark of a married woman. The ancient Sera Buddhist monastery, so friendly that I had another fantasy.
Namaste!
A 1,000 feet above Lhasa, the mountainside Papunka Monastery, where visitors offer yak butter prayer oil, and where Irma, a longtime student of Buddhism, offered her scarf in the Tibetan custom. The holy mountain was festooned with multicolored prayer flags. We added ours with our names and our wishes.
Take out the papers and the trash. Or you don't get no spending cash. If you don't scrub that kitchen floor, you ain't gonna rock and roll no more. Yabbity yak!
Don't talk back.
The shaggy, useful yak symbolizes Tibet. We ate yak stew and yak burgers, but where were the yaks? Finally, just up the Papunka Mountain from where Tibetans leave their dead for the vultures in sky burials, we spotted an honest-to-goodness yak. In another overseas adventure travel specialty home visit, a Tibetan widow named Dolma served the Americans yak butter tea and in return received a $2 bill from $2 Bill. Nima folk sang us 41 miles south to Gong Ga Airport.
The most memorable for me and the part that had the most meaning was visiting Tibet. It just didn't seem like a possible destination, but we made it happen. That was an experience to actually see the people of Tibet, to walk inside their monasteries, and you really feel how much they value their religion.
Chiang Kai-shek's much-bombed World War II capital, Chongqing, doesn't have much left from those days. It's Manhattan on the Yangtze, an industrial sprawl with an astounding 33 million people. Awaiting us for a river cruise was the Victoria Jenna. Captain Li Longhai welcomed the passengers, and we were off down the Yangtze at nearly 4,000 miles, the world's third longest river behind the Nile and the Amazon. In our cabins, CNN started to mention China's territorial squabble with the Philippines, Vietnam, and the U.S. over the South China Sea. The screen suddenly went black.
Very surprised how they censor our TV and news channels, and I didn't see that in any other country.
The luxury ship had a 5-star rating, but still, we could not drink the tap water. There is so much competition in the Yangtze cruise game that this voyage had only 121 passengers, far below the Victoria Jenna's capacity of 378. But that gave ship Dr. Li the time to talk Chinese medicine with Marty Finkelstein, a prominent New York physician. Ah yes, those picture postcard pagodas, but also those coal-fired power plants and the usual air pollution, the cough-inducing real China. Water pollution too. The romantic old river, which the Chinese simply call the Long River, not the Yangtze, is grungy with storm runoff and industrial waste. The crew doubled as entertainers nightly, and though the shows may have lacked perfection, there was no lack of beauty. There were even costumes of my favorite minority, the Meow. Nearing the famed Three Gorges Dam on our 410-mile sail, we stopped at Shibaojai, where some of the 1.3 million people displaced by the massive project were relocated. We home-visited the displaced farmer Tong Fu Li and his 4-year-old grandson. He told us the government had compensated him adequately and that he felt better off than in his now flooded village. Of course, it's doubtful that the tour company would set us up with a bitter anti-government dam victim. For telling his story, Mr. Tong got a $2 bill.
I think the people look very happy. People are very friendly. It was very enjoyable. I didn't know what to expect among Chinese people living under this system, and I'm very pleasantly surprised.
Traversing the narrow three gorges, the Chu Tang, the Wu, the Shi Ling, amid plunging cliffs less spectacular than before the dam raised the upper river's level in 2009. On smaller craft, a diversion up the 20-mile Goddess Stream in the lesser gorges. Here is the remote mountain canyon of the Hanging Coffins, where 2,000 years ago the Ba people placed their dead in lofty caves. At last, the controversial Three Gorges Dam, a $30 billion flood control project that, for all its social costs, makes the river safer for navigation while producing 2% of China's electricity, equal to 15 nuclear power plants. Last stop, the former British Crown colony that reverted to China in 1997 after 150 years, but was allowed to keep its relatively freewheeling political system until 2047. One of the world's busiest container cargo ports, Hong Kong reflects its British background in many ways. Motorists drive on the left. A pun mocks Chinese-accented English. Anglican churches endure. Double-decker trams and buses fill the streets. At Government House, near where youthful crowds in 2014 protested Beijing's moves to limit Hong Kongers' choice of election candidates, vicious fencing guards against renewed troubles. Most of the 7 million Hong Kongers live middle-class lives, but as a gleaming center of finance and world trade, Hong Kong shows off great wealth. Rolls Royces, Ferraris, more Teslas than in Beverly Hills. After two nights of Hong Kong glitter, from a star ferry crossing of Victoria Harbor, to the Victoria Peak view, to the sailor bars of the red light district, our tour ended 4,441 miles through eternal yet fast-changing China, and with only a little Luahua chaos.
Time and everybody's been wonderful. People are very friendly and I've had a good time. A
couple of the main cities, I actually didn't even know they existed. One is Chongqing.
Very unique, very nice, very enjoyable, a lot of walking.
Well worth the visit. It's not a place I'd probably come back to. The water's too dirty.
That's one thing, yeah.
Along with the happy rooms.
I think this is the best group I never had. Everyone is smart and well-educated. Everyone give me a great support.
I think that there is need for changes, and that will happen with every society as they advance and mature. And I'm very hopeful, and I think this was a wonderful experience.